On today's show, we're catching up with Brian Michael Bendis to find out all about the future of Superman. So get ready for DC All Access. Hey guys, I'm Whitney Moore, and it's time for DC Nation, where we get an inside look at this week's must-read straight from the publisher's desk.
You know, I'm really excited about a lot of things coming out. You know, we've been building towards June for a while. And what I mean by that is that when we started with the DC Nation special, the Zero, first week of May, a lot of that was really going into a lot of books that were really, really starting to catch fire coming June. So what you saw in May was that we had the DC Nation Zero special, which teased the wedding. So now you're going to see some more of the Batman teased wedding. We've been doing a lot of prelude material. And it was fun because Tom King had a really tight, concise story that he really wanted to get to that culminates in issue 50. But one of the things I felt was missing was really those beats where the heroes and villains fought right before the wedding. So they really crafted this really interesting prelude where a lot of the villains are now organizing to basically try to take on and destroy the wedding. Oh. And we have a lot of fun little specials coming out and a lot of things coming out. And so this particular week, we're gonna be seeing Nightwing versus Hush as part of the wedding specials. And you'll see a bunch of wedding specials coming up. I love the fun pairings that are gonna come out of this and characters that you don't normally see interacting or battling. You know, we have this incredible, great Batman's Rogues Gallery and this great Batman family of characters. So it's fun to see those guys interacting without Batman in the center. So I think that's the fun part of that story that's coming together.
Oh yeah, there are a lot of ways to sabotage a wedding too.
There is,
somebody's
yeah.
gonna get too drunk.
I watch all those Real Housewives things. I know how weddings fall apart pretty easy. But I think this one takes the cake.
Awesome! I can't wait.
So also the other thing that we set up was the No Justice series in the Zero Special. So we saw that going on. Again, No Justice came right out of it. It was big, noisy, crazy, epic, insane feel. But it was really more of a setup to get us to what the main event is, which is the first issue of Justice League.
Right.
And the first issue of Justice League, we got Jim Chung on the art. Mm-hmm. And I can't express what he's brought to that book. When I first opened it up and I saw his pages with the introduction, the Hall of Justice, and then really the lineup of the Legion of Doom characters, it really is quite special. Mm. And it's great to see his art on our characters, and it really brings that freshness to the Justice League that I think it needed. Scott's got a wonderful voice for that. He's got good plans in place, but really, this first issue, it delivers everything it's supposed to.
What do you think differs about his art as opposed to artists you guys have had in the past?
You know, it's interesting when you say that because we have so many great artists here working at DC, and they've touched so many of our characters. So when somebody brand new comes in of his caliber, you want to see just what their interpretation is. And it reminds me of when Andy Kuber came over to DC. And I was a huge Andy Kuber fan. I never saw him draw any of the DC characters when he came over. They all felt like they just came to life in a new way. And I feel the same thing with Jim. It really is the level of meticulous detail in the characters. There's a softness to the characters. There's a strength to the characters. And there's a lot of emotion on the page is what we really want to do. Because where No Justice was big, noisy, bombastic, this gets us back to the characters again. Yeah. And you got somebody who really helped set up their personalities in a great way.
That's
so
awesome.
A lot of fun there too. So that's Justice League. Mm-hmm. And also coming out is we know we still have Man of Steel running.
Yeah.
So Man of Steel started last week. We got part two coming out right now. We have a lot of fun stuff that's happening with the series, and it really is a weekly event that really introduces not just Superman in a new way, but Brian Bendis to the DCU. Mm-hmm. So it's fun to start this Brian Bendis period of time with Superman, and these books are what we had hoped them to be. Mm-hmm. But again, just like that, I can't wait till we get to Superman 1 and Action 1001, where his stories really kick into high gear.
I am a huge Bendis fan, and so I just cannot wait to see what he does here.
Well, you will not be disappointed. There's a lot of great setup. There's a lot of mystery that's set up in this story. It recalibrates the storyline without changing anything that you saw before. Mm-hmm. I think that's what's important. It really is moving everything that's been established to this point forward in a new way.
Well said. I love that. That's awesome. Okay, what else you got?
I'm very excited because this one we had slowed down a little bit, and it's actually the final New Age of Heroes books, The Unexpected.
Awesome.
And Steve Orlando with Ryan Sook have really found a way to redesign some really old, obscure characters. Mm-hmm. Something that Steve loves to do. But the one thing with Unexpected, because this is the last of the New Age of Heroes books, I don't want people to think we've seen it all, done it all up to this point. Reality is, what's great about this book, it is what we wanted the title to be, which is Unexpected. Mm-hmm. There should be weird twists and turns every issue that leave you a little off center, a little off guard. Cool. So from my standpoint, this is nice because this really caps everything that we plan to do with New Age of Heroes. Mm-hmm. Really brings it to full fruition, and the 8 titles that we introduced, I really think accomplished so many goals for us and really filled in so many interesting corners of the DCU in a way that I can't wait for them to see move forward, you know?
Awesome. And, are there any characters that are getting an update that you want to hint
at? Well, you know, I mean, in this book, there's a new Firebrand, and Firebrand's a longtime character in the DC. It started with Quality Comics way back in the day. I think it was part of the Freedom Fighters for a little while. Then it was reinterpreted a couple of times over. Past that, had his own series for a while, but this is a new female version of the character,
cool,
which I think is really strong. And then there's a character that both Steve and I have this weird love for that I don't understand, that's unexplained, which is called Neon the Unknown, which is, I think I just love the name of the character.
Yeah.
And he found a way to really reintroduce him in a way, and I can't stress enough just the level of creativity that Ryan Sook has brought in, mm-hmm, on the visuals. Ryan's visual style is really what brought that book to life, mm-hmm, just like with all the New Age books. You
awesome.
Know, I'm having a wonderful time working with Kenneth Ruckford on the Sideways stuff, and you know, he kind of just went in and just did a whole bunch of new redesigns for some old DC ideas that we're bringing into the Dark Multiverse. And
whoa,
because of that, it just shows you that, you know, we can always look at what we have, but the modernization of it, the contemporizing a lot of these ideas and really bringing them into our timeline right now just is a way to really acknowledge the history of DCU, mm-hmm, while still finding a way to attract new people and push things forward.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, before I let you go, I saw this cover and I really want to ask you about it. It's pretty great. Ah, oh, that's awesome.
Well, this came out last week. So this came out May 30th. These are part of our Hanna-Barbera crossovers. You know, and I have a lot, you know, when we do DCU Hanna-Barbera crossovers, I have a lot of fun with them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, these are all characters that are part of the Warner Brothers stable, and I just love exploring them.
Mm-hmm.
They're part of so many of our fans' childhoods that they love to see going on, but we've been doing that, and we just announced also all the Looney Tunes crossovers. And we freaked a lot of people,
yeah,
out with the artwork because it was really kind of creepy, but it kind of fun.
Oh,
but we
gosh.
Have, so what we did, the first time through, we did Hanna-Barbera, DCU versus the 60s Hanna-Barbera characters.
Mm-hmm.
Then we introduced the Looney Tunes characters meeting the DCU heroes. Now we're doing the 70s Hanna-Barbera characters meeting the DCU. Mm-hmm. Then the next wave is going to be a DC villains meets the Looney Tunes.
Oh my
so
gosh.
So you got Joker, Daffy, Gossamer, Harley Quinn, Sylvester and Tweety and Catwoman, and then the pièce de resistance, Lex Luthor, Porky Pig, you know.
Oh my gosh.
Where they're claiming Capri Shines.
Yep, that's gonna be so fun. I can't wait.
It's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun stuff there.
Those are a few titles to add to your pull list, and here's a roundup of every new DC book out today. Updates from the farthest reaches of the multiverse. The Girl of Steel got an elegant retelling of her origin story in the hit miniseries Supergirl Being Super, and you can experience the adventure from start to finish in the brand new collected edition right now. On top of that, the full run of the core Dark Knights Metal series is collected in a new hardcover for fans who have been living under a rock for the past year. Metal is essential reading for understanding the current state of DC Comics, so pick up your copy today. The Dark Knight's metal badassery does not stop there. This Friday, WB Records is releasing a new song from the metal soundtrack called Brief Exchange, sung by Chino Moreno from the Deftones. You can listen to the song wherever you stream music on Friday. And finally, get ready for an explosion of video game announcements coming out of E3 next week, and make sure you check back with DC All Access for in-depth coverage on all the big DC news. That's the news for now, but don't go anywhere. We've got Brian Michael Bendis on the other side of the panel of the week. Brian Michael Bendis debuted his take on Superman last week with the first issue of The Man of Steel, and we're catching up with him to pick his brain about his big picture plans for The Last Son of Krypton.
So Action Comics 1000 is out, and our surprise is it wasn't a prelude, You were deep into the story. It's actually in the third act of our Man of Steel story, the chapter that me and Jim did. We meet the villain and we already find out that he can beat Superman. He is Superman's equal, if not better. And Superman has no idea who this person is or where they came from or how on earth he can get his ass kicked this badly down the streets of Metropolis. So already you're asking yourself, who is he? What does he want? Where did he came from? And how could Superman possibly defeat him and still live the code that he lives by? And that's what people will want to know. If Superman can beat this guy and still be Superman. And then it's the weekly, boom, boom, boom. Six issues in a row, six weekly issues with momentum building with every issue. It's a nice way for us to put our mark in the sand and say, this is where you can hop on. You know, our world's very complicated. It's very hard to know what book should I get? Where should I come in? And Man of Steel number one, because it doesn't get easier than that. So two things are going on. We're in the modern day, and there's also a flashback. And in the modern day, here's Superman, here's Metropolis. There's another story being told where someone who is lighting a lot of building fires around Metropolis, which is crazy. Like, who would start fires in Superman's backyard? But someone is. It's a rash of suspicious fires. And we meet the new deputy fire inspector named Melanie Moore, who's going to be part of the book going forward. We see what's going on with Clark. We go to the Daily Planet, where it's very clear that Lois Lane doesn't work there anymore. Where's Lois and where's the kid? And in flashback, we get a sense that something may have happened. We don't know what, but in every issue of Man of Steel, another clue as to what happened to Lois and John will be unveiled in flashback, and all of our cards will be turned over by the end of the miniseries, and we're going to find out what's happened to Superman's family. Are they okay? Are they alive? Is this Earth? All of these questions will be answered by the end of the series.
That's it for this episode, but remember that you still have time to enter to win our Kryptonian prize pack of collectibles and comics. For your chance to win, visit dccomics.com/watchandwin and fill out the form with your information. It's so easy, even your cousin who locked himself in the trunk of a car for 4 hours could do it. Good luck, and we'll see you next time.